So now your method can be a, basically, we don't have to describe it with one line. Basically, it shows semicolon use comma here.
Right.
So what you say is a let. So what it says let dot z equal to sum of dollars plus dollar y, and then returning 2 into dollar here. So basically, if you separate multiple statements by comma, then those statements are executed one by one, and the output of the last statement is the output of the whole function.
Right.
So just read it using saying that. Okay, that z equal to x plus y, and then returning 2 into z.
Right.
So it's easy to see, you can write your own methods. For example, you could have said, it takes a book input and returns only the reviews. You don't need to write that return filter, okay? I mean, it will just give you, I mean, you can call this function, it will only return a set of arrays which are basically reviews. So basically, in a JavaScript, you can write methods like that and then make them use those methods repeatedly to save on your programming efforts. Okay, there's some more business function, let's say exist check for whether an attribute exists in a record or not. Is null check whether that is null or not. Range basically says it takes two values, range, minimum, max. So it says range 1 to 10 will be, its output will be a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 7, 8, 9, 10. So it takes two input, two integer, and just returns an array, which are basically of size max max min. If you say range 1 to 5 will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, if you say range 2 and 5 will be 2, 3, 4, 5. So it's sometimes useful to write for, then you can say for I in range 2 and 5. So it will, if you want to just operate on, let's say, only empty, just want to operate, say you've got 10 books, you want to operate on your first 5 books. Then you can say for I in range 1 to 5. So then if you do something inside this for, then you're just going to touch the first 5 books. You're going to touch the last 5. Or if you want to say, I want to just process only even number books, then probably you will say, okay, range 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and multiply by 2. Then you will get 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. The point is, with this range, you can get any array, right, by using this function range. Top basically takes an array, returns the first element of it. So, if it just returns, if array is x, it will return x2, right? And then you can say top array and 5. It will return the first 5 elements. If you want to know the first 5 elements, you say top array 5, so it will get the first 5. If you want to know the last, then you say left. The leg will give you the last element, and if you leg 3, then it will give you the last 3 elements of the array. Compare basically is like string comparison, strcmp, right? It's just like two inputs, compares. If the first value is greater than the second value, it will give you return a 1. If they're equal, then 0, if the first value is minus 1, right? It could compare, you can take any integer for string, anything. Type of basically returns whether you can take an attribute and this query whether it's an integer, float, or whatever. So that type of returns, like in the C you have type of. So that's the same thing. The string takes an array and returns only the unique elements. So it just drops all the repeating elements. Merge takes two JSON records and merges them. So if your first, let's say you have got two books cataloged, dollar books 1 and books 2. Books 1 has got 10 records, books 2 has got 20 records. If you merge both of them, it will contain 30 records. Right? Again, for merging, it doesn't require that the schema should be the same. So merge just takes two JSON records, set of JSON records, just merges them. Okay, so now suppose your data is in file. So how do you get in dollar books? You just say dollar books, you're going to read file books.txt. It should be the full path. If it is a local file system, if it's an STF file system, you just say dollar books, you're going to read STF books.txt. So if you have to write to a local file, you have to say dollar books, write file, dollar books, write STF. So that way you can read and write to the file and convert from the file. Okay, break into multiple statements. So again, you can just like in Java, you break into multiple statements, so you can do just the same. For example, this is a command, dollar books, it filters where the average review rating greater than 5 and then retains only the author and title. This is equivalent to saying, I just take the first statement, output that, I'm buying the output of that statement into dollar x. So I'm saying dollar x equal to dollar books, filter, retain only those books where the average rating greater than 5. And I'm binding it dollar x. And then I'm writing second statement which takes dollar x and transform author and title. So basically it doesn't need to be, basically keep piping. I mean, because if you have more than 4 or 5, it becomes a bit messy to keep track of what is what. So the point is just break it down. Just store it in a local variable and then use it anywhere you want. That's how you break any statement into multiple records. So if you can break and you have a method, so I think Jekyll method, that means you can basically write any large Jekyll script using these features. Okay, how do you extend Jekyll using a Java class? This is a basic skeleton. Just like you write a Java class, this is an example, say I'm saying print attribute is my class name. What I want to do here is, I want to take an array of JSON records, and for each record I want to print the value for the attribute it is here. Right? So this is how you do go about it. We want to write a Java UDL to define this is my class, print attribute. And then the function is called eval. Basically we're trying to extend Jekyll using Java, you write an eval function. Right? You give whatever name you want to give to your class and write an eval function inside it. The point is, and then inputs are every JSON type is there is a corresponding Java type. So if it's an integer, it will call JSON name. So directly integer will not call the Java integer. Similarly, Java float, they will not call it. Eval will take only JSON types. So for integer, there's a JSON name. For float, there's a JSON float. For string, there's a JSON string. For array, it's a JSON array, right? So it takes JSON types as input, returns JSON types as output. Or it can be point. So that's a basic skeleton. Write a class name, you can give whatever class name you want to give, and write an eval function. Just define an eval method. And there can be multiple eval methods, then how the types are matching basically, that will call the corresponding eval function. But you cannot write just any random function. The my function, that will not work. You have to write an eval function, the signature of that method should be eval. You should take any JSON variables as input, return JSON types. Inside this, basically you can do any normal Java stuff, right? So you can say basically, right, okay, I'm going to iterate over JSON iterator, JEdit item. I iterate over all the records, get individual JEdit record, get the attribute value, and then print it out, right? So you can write this class, put it in the class path, right? And then from a Jekyll script, you can directly say print attribute dollar books, right? You can say print attribute dollar books title, right? Then this function is going to print title of the book, or all the books in the dollar books, right? So there come sometimes, let's say you want to define do something. This is a machine learning algorithm you want to implement. Oh, now that cannot be implemented in Jekyll. So just write it can be, but probably it will be much easier to write in Java if you want to write any machine learning algorithm. So you just write it out in Java, code it in, and just put this class into the class path, and then just keep calling. Right. So when it calls print attribute, it calls basically the eval method that matches the input description. So that's how you extend Jekyll in Java class. Okay, then you can write custom MapReduce scripts in Jekyll. So for example, one thing is you write MapReduce in Java, but in Jekyll also you can, using just Jekyll script, you can write MapReduce script. For example, it's saying, if you want to find out the number, count the number of objects for each X value. Given any collection, I want to find out how many times each word is occurring. Things like that. So for example, then say look, input type is SDFS and the file is sample.dat. It is in the Azure file system. My output should go to results.dat and I get the SDFS. Then I hope, if you understand how MapReduce works, basically map, it is taking and it takes a record $i, returns it $i.x and a value 1, saying this value occurs x one time. And then again, reduce takes x and the set of values for it, it has a count of it. Right? It's a normal MapReduce thing. And that's how you can write a MapReduce in the Jekyll. Okay, so data is not in JSON format. Right now, we are seeing if the data is in JSON format. That's the key value pair. Now, data will be a CSV format. So the point is, if it is CSV format, you've got to convert it in JSON format. Right? It's not required that data should be stored in the JSON format. You've got CSV, then you can write again your Java UDF. That takes a file, okay, you can take the file name into JSON string, pass that file on your whatever way you want to do, and return a set of JSON records. Then those JSON records can be piped to rest of the Jekyll script. And then again, Jekyll has got some fixed set of, for CSV, you can define, it's called format and converter. In format, you can define, these are my column names, and this class to JSON test converter will just take CSV as the first column is this attribute, second column is this attribute, and then give you the just a JSON representation in object. So if you can get your work done by using any of the basic Jekyll converter format, that's fine. Otherwise you can write your own class, your own converter. Means I can specify this is my converter, and then that's how to do that. Okay, so that's what it is. Okay. So I think if you download the current one, which is Jekyll 0.4, you will get whatever I have described here now. And the 0.5, what we are doing, as you will see here, is that we are integrating, I mean, various ones. I mean, let's say R is a machine learning package, Weka is a data mining package, machine learning. So it's making, it's putting an effort so that these products are well integrated into Jekyll. So you can call any Weka function from Jekyll itself. So right now, it is just call, but it will not be. It will not be executed as a MapReduce job inside, because it's not a simple, doing a data mining algorithm is not a simple job. So that just runs on a single machine, but you can just call from Jekyll. Right now we are working on how to basically make these individual jobs as basically MapReducible. When you say I want to learn a decision tree from this data, so right now when we just do it in Vega, I just upload my input file, say I want to learn the decision tree, then at the moment, it will get executed in one machine. It will go through the usual.